Let's go ahead and stand, and we're going to go ahead and go to God with worship this morning. Fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath that blood, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath that blood, lose all their guilty stains. The dying deep rejoice to see that fountain in his day. And there have I no far as he washed all my sins. Washed all my sins away. And there have I, though vile as he, washed all my sins away. Ever since by faith I saw the stream that flowing wounds supply, where saving love has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Has been my king and shall be till I die. Man, give it up to God this morning.
Your love will always be enough. Can I have a seat?
Hey, good morning, Valley Harvest. How are you doing this morning? Oh, good, you're awake. Well, if you haven't realized it yet, there are 56 shopping days till Christmas. And if I've just stressed you out, I have a calendar in the back to how to plan and organize your life for the next month and a half so that you can get everything done. I don't know, can you think about that one gift when you were a kid that you received that you've never been able to forget? Think about that for a minute while we watch this little short video.
My name is Eve and I'm from Rwanda. As a little boy, I grew up in Togo, West Africa. The ripple effects of the Rwandan genocide sent my family into a lifelong journey of searching for hope and a safe haven. My father was a pastor in Togo. Even though my father was a pastor, we were surrounded by voodoo idol worshippers who swore never to set foot in a Christian church. When I was 11 years old, that all changed when Operation Christmas Child came into my community. For the first time, we saw voodoo idol worshippers and their children come to church because they had heard about these gifts that were given out. Operation Christmas Child made a way for these unbelievers to be exposed to the gospel of Jesus Christ, which eventually radically changed my whole community. When the main witch doctor gave his life to Christ, for the first time in many years, I felt cared for and not forgotten, especially by the rest of the world. I remember that day as I opened my box. On a 90-degree day, the first thing I remember pulling out was a scarf, this cozy scarf of all things. 3 years later, my family moved to Buffalo, New York through a refugee resettlement program, which allowed me to finally be able to use that same cozy scarf to keep me from the harsh winters of upstate New York. This showed me that God can use anything and anywhere to bring hope where all hope is lost. These shoeboxes that you pack, not only can they change individual lives, but they can also change entire communities like I have seen in my life. Thank you for your generosity and faithfulness and for your willingness to pack these simple shoeboxes and for keeping me warm in cold Buffalo.
So it's the power of a simple gift. And we're going to be packing shoeboxes in the next couple of weeks, and that's where we need your help. So I don't know if you got it from the video, but it's not just the gift. It's a tangible thing that we use to give to somebody else. And when we give it to somebody who's never received gifts before, it's pretty powerful and it's pretty amazing. It's also love, letting them know that somebody loves them. Somebody across the world loves them and is thinking about them. In every shoebox, Samaritan Purse puts the gospel of Jesus Christ in their language. And they get to find out that Jesus loves them. But it goes one step farther. Most of those children that receive the shoebox will get the opportunity to participate in a discipleship program called The Greatest Journey. And they will learn who Jesus Christ really is and who God the Father is. And they'll learn how to share their faith and with other people. So that is the difference we're going to make with packing our shoeboxes. That's where you come in. Pack a shoebox. It's really simple. First of all, when you leave today, I got shoeboxes back there. Pick up 1, 2, 10, 20. I have more. So take the whole tree in the back, and we'll fill it up again next time. Decide if you're going to pack for a boy or girl, and then what age you're going to do. There is envelopes in the back that talk about what can go in a shoebox. Fill it up. Toys, candy, hygiene items, school supplies. There's a list of things that you can put in there and a list of a few things that you can. We can't put liquid stuff in there. We can't put war-related items and can't put chocolate because it'll melt. There's a label that'll go on there. They have a great thing now. It's called Track Your Box. If you choose to, you can go online and the website's in here and you can fill out and get one of these and it'll print out with a barcode on. And then you'll get an email when you're shoeboxes delivered to see what country it went to. Just like last year, we're going to put a map up in the foyer and we're going to track those boxes. So when you get that email, text me, bring it to me at church, or just put a little thing. I'll have it on there so you can put what country it went into. The important thing to remember, because some of you came up and said, I never got an email. When you put that barcode on there, don't cover your barcode up with tape. Because if you've ever tried to scan anything in your life, you'll know it doesn't really work really well with tape. So, a couple of things that you need to know. First of all, they ask if it's all possible to include $7. And you can include that. You can pay for it online when you track your box, or you can put it in this envelope. That $7 helps to pay for the supplies. It helps to pay to ship, because if you've ever shipped anything anywhere, it costs a lot of money. $7 is a pretty good deal. The second thing you should include in there is something about yourself, maybe a picture of your family. If you have kids, I have these on the back table. talks about they can fill it out and color it and put it in there. You can do a couple extras and bring them back to me because we're going to have a packing party and we'll have boxes that we can put them in. And the most important thing to do with your box is to pray for them. Prayer is the most amazing thing. So pray for your box, not only when you pack it, but continue to pray for them as they deliver them over the next couple of months. So bring them back. Our collection week is going to be November 14th, so we would love to have the shoeboxes back here on November 13th, so as a church we can pray for them. That only gives you 14 days. So whether you have 56 days to shop for Christmas, you only have 14 days to shop for Operation Christmas Child. Bring them back, and we're going to stack them up here someplace. You'll see where they're going to be. If you want to, join us for our packing party. That's going to be Friday night, November 11th at 6 o'clock over in the CWC. So I hope to see you then. Grab a couple shoeboxes. Fill it with gifts, fill it with a picture, fill it with prayer, and fill it with love, because that's the greatest thing in the world. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
you for what you've done for us, for dying on the cross and saving us of our sins. Father, you washed all of our iniquities away whenever you drank in the cup of wrath from your Father. And you said it was finished. And we were saved. God, we just thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You can have a seat.
Well, good morning. It's good to see everyone out on this nice rainy morning. Thank God for the rain. It might make us wet and our hair look funny, but we need it. You can open your Bibles up to the Gospel of Luke chapter 15 as we continue in this study that we of the prodigal son. We've actually taken our cues from a book written by Tim Keller called The Prodigal God, as we over these past 4 weeks and over the next two. And today, we're going to be looking particularly in the story that Jesus gives at this character of the older brother and his response to this father's love that's poured out to this younger son. I know you just sat down, but may I ask you to stand again? I'm going to go and just read this text for us. I'm going to begin in verse 11 of Luke chapter 15, and I'm going to read the whole story. And here Jesus is speaking, and it says, "There was a man who had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me.' And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish here with hunger. I will rise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a ways off, his father saw him, and he felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and has been found,' and they began to celebrate. Now, his older brother was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And the servant said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he's received him back safe and sound.' But the older brother was angry and refused to go in. And his father came out and entreated him. But the brother answered his father, 'Look, these many years I've served you, and I've never disobeyed your command, yet you've never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him.' And he said to him, 'Son, you are with me always, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your younger brother was dead and is alive. He is lost and is found.' Lord, I ask that you would bring to light the truth that we are all prodigal sons at some point when we come to you, and that just because we've entered into your family does not mean that we do not act like this older brother at some point. I pray that you would help us to see ourselves in light of your parable here, Jesus. In your name we pray, amen. You may be seated. It's important that whenever you read the Bible, that you read the Bible within its given context. And so 2 weeks ago, we looked at Luke chapter 15, and it starts off in verse 1 and 2, and saying that Jesus was at this time of giving the story, that he was sitting with tax collectors and sinners, and he was sitting with a group called the Pharisees. The Pharisees were this highly religious people group that were disdainful of sinners and tax collectors. These two people groups did not fellowship together or hang out. And yet Jesus is here eating with them at this party. And the Pharisees are beginning to complain and saying, who is this Jesus eating with sinners like this? And so Jesus gives them these stories, and Luke begins with two, as a matter of fact, Jesus begins in Luke with two stories. You have a parable of the lost sheep, then you have the parable of the lost coin, and this is the third one that Jesus is giving. Now realize that Jesus gives these parables for a very real purpose. And in this parable, Jesus is likening the elder brother to the religious people who treat God as if God owes them something. As if God owes them, has some kind of standard of living that he owes them. And really, Jesus is leading these people to the conclusion that religious people are just as lost as non-religious people. I hope you see that here today, that just because you've been in the church or because you've disciplined yourself to adopt some good Christian habits does not necessarily mean that you are not lost or that you are in the family of God. And that is Jesus' point as we look at what we'll call Act 2 today and this older brother. So it starts off in verse 25, you know, verse 11 through 24 we'll call Act 1. That was where the son, this younger boy comes and asks his dad for his inheritance. It was highly disrespectful in Jesus' day. It was like wishing the father dead. And the amazing thing was that the father did it. The father, instead of giving him the proverbial slap in the face and disowning him, the father divided up his portion, his living, and gave it to the son. And what's the son do? He runs off. Goes and just, you know, he parties it up for we don't know how long until finally he comes to the end of himself, makes his way home, and the father forgives him as we just read. And then we pick up in this third character here in verse 25. It says this older son, this brother, was in the field, and he's outside. He's working, and he's coming near the house, and he hears a party happening. He hears this party, and he asks what's going on, and he's made aware that his younger brother came home, and we're told in verse 28 that he was angry. He's angry, and that he refused to go in. I want you to first see here the elder brothers are also estranged from the father, but they will not admit it. So when we are talking about religious people, we're saying that we can be in underneath the roof of God's household and still be very much estranged and from God. That we can come together and do religious things and be just as lost as someone who has nothing to do with God, nothing to do with his people, nothing to do with the church. And so here is the son here. Now, interesting is that as he's out in this field and he's approaching, he hears this celebration. Now, if you loved your father, if you loved your family member, and matter of fact, if I hear a celebration going on, I want to know what's going on. I'm interested. I'm curious, just like he is, except here's a difference. I think that if where I lived, you know, you would have heard this celebration anywhere about maybe a half a mile away. And I think from where I live, that if I heard loud music, I knew there was a celebration going on at the church, but I didn't know what it was about, I'd be thinking, wow, what's going on down at the church? And I would be thinking, something great must be happening there. I got to go see what it is. There is an indication from this text that he already had a negative disposition. He wasn't saying, wow, what's going on? That he was thinking, what's happening at home? Because when he comes there, he says that he asked one of the servants, and this word servant actually has the idea that it was a little kid. It was one of the little kids that would have been outside likely, you know, of the house, and he asked him, what's going on at home? This son, instead of going inside to find out, has to ask somebody else. And so the servant lets him know, your brother has come home and your father's received him and he's killed the fatted calf. The son would have been smelling, hearing the music. He would have been smelling the Texas barbecue going. You know what I'm talking about, right? You're thinking about lunch already right now, aren't you? And he would have smelt all that, and this older brother would have known that my brother's come home, and my father's killed the fatted calf. He would have known that this would have been the greatest day of the father's life. I mean, do you really think that this younger son left home and that the father just kind of went on with his life and that no one knew that the father was intensely grieved and burdened by his son who had wandered from home and who had left the family? You know when someone in the household is hurting. And this son would have known this, that this father was grieving his son. And instead of celebrating, and instead of, even if he's upset with his brother, he doesn't even know what his brother said yet. He hasn't even heard his brother. Has he repented? Has he brought anything back with him? I mean, what did he do with his living? How did he repent? Is he okay? He doesn't even think that. Immediately, and again, this is the father's greatest day of his life, he stays outside and refuses to go in because the father has killed the fatted calf. Now, as I said last week, that this was not just any party. You don't just go kill the fatted calf because your team won the Super Bowl. You don't just go kill the fatted calf, on any given day. This was a highly special delicacy in Jesus' day, and it was expensive. And so the older son realized that his father was ecstatic with joy, and yet he refused to go into the biggest feast his father's ever put on. This was a remarkable, deliberate act of disrespect towards his dad. You know, I've been in a lot of weddings, and not all weddings are met with the same amount of approval, either from family or friends, are they? Sometimes people think, well, that couple shouldn't be married because either whatever the reason is, they're not compatible, or that person's a jerk. We don't know, but you know as well as I do that not everyone receives the marriage of a couple the same. Nonetheless, whether you still have people join in the celebration, that even if they don't necessarily think this is the best person or the best time to do this, they join in the celebration because it is the biggest day of their life. Correct? This was the biggest day of the father's life. The son will have nothing to do with it. He won't even support the father in this. And it was like saying, I will not be a part of this family, and I will not respect your headship of it. So just as, notice this, that so the father, just as he had to go out and meet the younger son, he also has to go out and meet the oldest boy. I think there's something to be said here, and I think Jesus means to communicate this, is that you and I don't just come home and say, what's up? I'm here and I need to tell you I'm sorry. Notice that the father goes out and brings both kids into the house in verse 27. And so the father here represents God himself, and the meal is this feast of salvation. And so the younger son, and is the immoral man, comes in and is saved, but the older son, who is the good son, refuses to go in and is lost. Jesus is turning everything upon its head. The immoral one comes into the house and partakes in the feast of salvation. But the older son never comes back in. We're not told. We're just left that the story ends. And he's still outside. He's not a part of the family. The good son, the moral one, is lost. And so the Pharisees would have understood this is a complete reversal of everything that they believed. As Jesus says, that this son here says, look, these many years I've served you, and I've never disobeyed your command, and you've never even given me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. Notice that it's not this son's sin that's keeping him out. It's his righteousness. You and I must be very careful here today, because the gospel is not religion nor non-religion, and the gospel is not morality nor immorality. The gospel comes to you and I and it says, you bring nothing to the table, and even when you come into the house, you're still received because of what Christ did for you, because Christ brought you into his family. I don't come into God's family by being a good person, and I'm not kept in God's family by being a good person. That just blows my mind. That the grace of God would seek me out and bring me into his family and keep me there and continue to allow me to be a son. And so the older brother here, he's upset with the dad, and he assumes the right to tell the father what he should do with his possessions, and because he had perfectly obeyed him all the time. So I find here that there can be two ways of being lost. One is by breaking the rules and being very bad, and one is by keeping the rules and being very good. So this older brother here in verse 29, as we've seen, he says, I've served you all these years. I've never disobeyed your command, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I can celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours comes home, you killed the fatted calf for him. Notice also that elder brothers can be recognized by their sense of entitlement. They feel that this was mine, and you killed what was mine, and you did this, and this all has to... He's not concerned about the father's joy. He's concerned about his rights to his stuff. Because elder brothers, you know, they struggle, don't they? How can you recognize whether you are one of these religious people that are just trying to be really good and earn God's favor? Well, I've got a few signs here. I've got five of them. And number one, realize that elder brothers struggle with deep anger. They struggle with deep anger. In verse 28, it says, but he was angry and he refused to go in. And his father has to come out and entreat him. You know, these people believe that God owes them a comfortable and good life. And if they try hard to meet his standards. So they say, my life ought to be going better than this. And when they don't, they get angry. I'm absolutely convinced that many of us here today live with repressed anger inside. You know something my father taught me? He taught me that if you really want to see what's inside of someone, wait till they get into a stressful situation. Watch how they respond underneath the stress, because then you'll typically see whether they're real, what they're really dealing with. And, you know, I've been this way, and many of us struggle with this, and that we take this anger, and we keep this polite manner, these polite manners in front of everybody else. We try to be polite and acceptable, but inside, we're dealing with these emotions, and truth is, a lot of them get squashed, and they never get really dealt with, and that's exactly how religious people are with God, because they really, in their heart, believe that I'm good, therefore you ought to bless me. And yet God does not owe us anything. Don't forget this. Do you know who the best son is in the household of God? Jesus. Jesus is the best son that the Father has. There's no one like him. He never broke the rules. He kept every single one of them. And he suffered intensely. So elder brothers struggle with deep anger, as you see in verse 28. But notice also that elder brothers serve with joyless and mechanical obedience. They have this joyless and mechanical obedience in verse 29 that says, the son answers the father, look, these many years I have served you and never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat. What is this son saying? I mean, if he has a relationship with the father and if they love each other, you would think he would be, that there would have been years gone by that the father and the son had this relationship. And that there would have been plenty of memories at Hanukkah, right, or Christmas. You know, they had plenty of memories even while the son was gone. But the son's attitude toward it, according to verse 30, is, I have slaved for you all these years. In other words, my service given to you has been gruesome. It's been grueling. It's been hard work. In other words, he's not joyful. And everything he's been doing has been mechanical. And he's been obeying God as a means to an end. It's as a way to get the things that he really loves, which is not the Father, but the Father's stuff. See, I find that obedience to God sometimes can be extremely hard. And the more we invest, the greater the temptation to feel entitled. This happens, honestly, I think probably to every Christian at some point that begins to take their faith seriously and get involved in the ministries of the church. And you begin to serve, and you're grateful. But over time, the more you sacrifice, the more invested you are into that ministry and the more ownership you feel. And there's a good side to that. But sometimes we get pretty possessive about what that should look like, don't we? And we begin to think that we're entitled to things to be a certain way. And we're serving without joy. So this son has been serving, but he sees it as a gruesome task. Notice thirdly, the elder brothers tend to be cold to the younger brother types. And verse 30 says, but when this son of yours comes home. This is his brother he's talking about, but he will not acknowledge him as his brother. This is, you know what, if you want him in the family, then he's your son. He's not my brother. And when he comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him. I mean, this guy squandered what he had with prostitutes and prodigal living, and he's very cold. They feel unavoidably superior to those who are not trying as hard as they are. Guys, we get that way, don't we? We tend to judge people. I mean, come on, can't you pick up a little bit? I mean, can't you at least do this? Tend to be judgmental and cold. And older brothers are too disdainful of others, unlike themselves, to be effective in evangelism. I've been here. I've been one of those guys that knew the facts and witnessed to people, but all I did was just give them the facts, and they didn't really know that I loved them. I've never seen anyone come to Christ that way yet. Do you know that? He's cold. And I find that we can be that way towards people. And I realize that it's our understanding of our lostness, of our own lostness, that moves us to have pity on those that don't know the Father. You see, do you realize that God in his gracious love brought you into his family if you were his? And it was surely an act of mercy and grace. And that but for his mercy and grace, you'd be utterly lost. And the issue is that until I see other people just as lost as I once was, in other words, acknowledging my lostness, I will never be effectively helping them to come into the family of God. Notice fourthly that elder brothers tend to lack the assurance of the father's love, because he says back in again in verse 29, Dad, you never even threw me a party. You never threw me a party. But boy, my younger brother comes home and you throw him the best party ever. What is he doing? Do you hear the comparison there? Here's my younger brother, you throw a party. I never got a party. He is revealing his deep inner insecurity that he is not as loved by his father as his younger brother is. Oh, you know what that's like, don't you? Maybe you were the loved child of the family, but we all tend to compare ourselves to others. And as long as he's trying to control God through his goodness, he'll never be good enough. As long as you are trying to control God's blessings in your life by being good, you will never, ever be good enough. You will never, ever feel secure, because it's based upon what you do. And you'll never get there. And you'll always be struggling with guilt inside. And so what are the signs of this? Every time something goes wrong in your life, you wonder, am I being punished by God? Is God punishing me? Another sign is this irresolvable guilt. You can't be sure if you've repented deeply enough, so you beat yourself up over and over on what you did. When the Father just gives his love freely, you find that there's a lack of intimacy in your relationship with God, I have no doubt that you're struggling with assurance of the love of the Father. And so the son's saying, you never even threw me a party. You love him more than me, as he reveals his insecurity. But then finally he says, you know, but when this son of yours, what's he doing? He's being judgmental. And I find that elder brothers struggle with an unforgiving and judgmental spirit. He can't handle the fact that I've invested so much into this. And here he is. He didn't do nothing for it. He disrespected the whole family. And here I am, and I've done all this. And here comes this son of yours. He doesn't want the father to forgive the younger brother. And you know, it is impossible to forgive someone as long as you feel, I would never do something like that. As long as you feel superior to someone else, it's impossible to truly forgive them. This is shocking to Jesus' audience. You realize that Jesus' audience, the Pharisees, would have been saying, finally, someone in the family is saying what needs to be said. Finally, in this story, someone's doing what needs to be said, and they know exactly what Jesus is saying. You realize that we can all, at some point, be a Pharisee. We all can be harsh in the way that we judge other people. But here's the beauty of this story, I think. It comes out in verse 31. It says, the father says to this older brother, son, you're always with me. And all that is mine is yours. And it is fitting to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours, again, he's reminding him, he is part of the family. You're not kicking him out of the family. I don't care what he's done. He's still a part. It's good for us to celebrate because he's come home. And everything I have, it's yours. Don't worry about not having everything else. It's yours. You know what? We'll grow another fatted calf for you if that's your concern. We'll do all those things, but we must celebrate. But we're not told the son ever comes back into the family. Stops. It's done. Can elder brothers be restored to the father? I want you to know they can. The Bible's very clear that you do not have to remain outside of the family of God, that you can be restored. And that restoration happens when we see the uniqueness of the gospel. When you see the uniqueness of what Christ has done for us. See, the lostness of the older brother here is a more dangerous spiritual condition than the lostness of the younger brother. You know why? Because the younger brother knows exactly what he did. He knows where he stands in relationship to the family. But the older brother thinks he's okay, and he's not. And so one of the most dangerous things you and I can do is to get religious. Is to get religion and to try to appease Father and to earn his favor. See, if you tell a moral, religious person that they're alienated from God, how do they respond? They get ticked off. I know from experience. When you tell someone who's saying, I'm okay, I'm a Christian, and you begin to question that with them, my experience is they always kind of start getting annoyed with you. And I hear this one a lot. Don't judge me. I'm like, well, sorry, the Bible tells me to judge you. It tells me not to be a hypocrite and to judge myself first. And the Bible is very clear, and when people tend to get offended when they're religious, when you question where they're at, and it's this idea that I obey God, therefore God accepts me, versus I'm accepted by God through what Jesus Christ has done for me. You see, these are two radically different, even opposite dynamics. Both people sit in the church together and they pray and they obey the Ten Commandments, but they do it for radically different reasons. And because they do these things for radically different reasons, they produce radically different results. What different kinds of character, different kinds of who they are. One produces anger, joyless compliance, superiority and insecurity, and a condemning spirit. And the other slowly but inevitably produces contentment, joy, humility, and forgiveness. Notice that if we call younger brothers to receive Christ and to live for him without making this distinction clear, they will automatically think that we are calling them to become just like us. And that's not what the call is here today. You're not called to be just like us here at Valley Harvest or me or any other leader or the membership. You are called to be who God called you to be because he loves you. And restoration also happens when we see the vulnerability of Jesus. You need to see this here, is that Jesus is not being harsh with these people he's talking to, is he? You realize who Jesus is talking to? He is talking to the people that are going to execute him. And he's making them very angry, not on purpose, but he's appealing to them. You are so upset that I am eating with these sinners and tax collectors who don't keep all your rules. And they've not sought after God. They've been lost from the fold of God. And you're angry that I'm sitting here eating with them, and yet this is, you're just as lost as they are. And he's being so loving and tender. When the father comes out to the older brother, that is Jesus pleading with his enemies. He's urging them to see their fatal error. He's not screaming at them. He's not smiting them. He's coming to them lovingly, urging them to repent and to come into his love. You see, this love towards his enemies made Jesus vulnerable, and it cost him his life. Luke 23:34, do you remember what Jesus says on the cross? He says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do. The very people that are killing him, he's pleading for them. And Romans 5:10 says that while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more, now that we've been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Do you realize you do not have to live a life of judgmental harshness towards people? That God can build into you that love of Christ that pities people, that sees your lostness and responds to God in absolute utter joy? Do you know that joy of being related into the family of God today? Oh my friends, God is so good. And it matters not what you've done, because you never were good enough and you never will be. You cannot outsend the grace of God, but you can walk away from his offer of salvation, his invitation to the family. And oh, if the Father has awakened your heart this morning to see his goodness, you must respond, because when you walk out these doors, there is a very real world out there that will distract you and make you forget. And the miracle is that you would see here today the beauty of Christ, because Jesus is the good older brother. He doesn't let us just walk away. He is the older brother that goes after us, and he's come here today for you and I. That's the beauty of what of Jesus' story, is we're not left with something we don't know in real life, is that Jesus comes after you and me. You're not good enough. You never will be. Become a Christian, you'll never be good enough still. It's grace. As we close up here, the team comes up, makes their way up here. I want you to realize it's important that you make those decisions here today. It's important that you respond to what God is doing in your life. God will do the work. You know how we do this? I'll be in the back. And if God, if you feel, you know if God's talking to you right now, you sense it, don't you? And if you need prayer, if you need me to talk with you, I'll be in the back and I'll be ready to receive you. Stand with me. Lord, I can't help but to get kind of overly excited, because I am so amazed at what I have received from you that I do not deserve. And I know that we are all just as lost until you come and find us. And I ask that you would open eyes and ears to hear and to see. I pray that we would lay all of our works and our merits and everything we've ever done to be good down at your feet and count it as nothing and simply just receive your grace. Holy Spirit, move us into your family, I pray. In your name I pray, Jesus, amen.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the
as weeds which mar the chosen one. Bring many sons to You guys can have a seat as the ushers come forward.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask this morning that you may help us to give with a cheerful heart back to you, Lord, for all the things that you do for us. We ask for your blessings over the tithe. Bless the gift and the giver, and we thank you for all that you do in our lives. Amen.
Hello, ladies. Tis the season. Would you like to decorate your home with a holiday painting? If so, we would love to have you join us on November the 13th at 2 p.m. here at Valley Harvest. The tickets are on sale now, so we will be enjoying friends, fellowship, and of course, food. We love to see you soon. Okay.
Michelle!
Oh, sorry, Harvey.
What are you doing?
I'm getting ready for family game night.
Family game night? When is that?
November 6th. We are sliding into family game night.
What are we going to do, Michelle?
Oh, guess what, Carlene? It's a cook-off.
It is? Yes. Oh, good. What are we cooking, Michelle?
Well, you know, we are going to make something different this year. We're doing sliders.
What's a slider?
Oh, you know what? It's like a small bun stuffed with something special like chicken, meat, shrimp, vegetarian, doesn't matter.
Wow, that sounds fun. Are we doing anything else?
Oh, you know what, Carlene? Oh my gosh, I almost forgot. We're having a cookie bake-off as well.
Cookies this year? Oh my gosh, but
you like Michelle? You like my recipe?
I really think we need to have homemade cookies. I know you could do something fun. There's so much snickerdoodles.
For the bakers out there, get a family recipe together. Come together in the afternoon and bring some fresh cookies. Carlene, let's get the details, though. At 6 o'clock in Faith Hall, we're coming together. And guess what? I forgot to tell you, it's a life-size family game. All the families are going to come in. They're going to do some fun stuff. And then four families are going to stand off together for a life-size sorry game.
Wow. That sounds like fun. I can't wait, Michelle.
I'm so excited. Valley Harvest, don't forget to mark it on your calendar. We need our families to come together, spend time together, and share our time. Valley Harvest! It's a family game night!
Thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard tender whispers in the dead of night, and you tell me that the reason that I'm never alone, you're a good goodbye.
It's who you are.
It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Yes, our Father is good, isn't he? Oh, by grace, just don't forget that. I want to personally thank everyone that helped us out with our trunk or treat event last night. If you gave candy or helped out, it paid off, because, you know, we gave away 900 invitations to church today. And so, I mean, I just want to thank everyone who partook of that. We also won first place. So, yeah, woo, right? We won first place. But really, it's just a great point, way of us touching, being a touch point with the community and being a part of this, of the people that we love, right? So thank you for participating in that. Don't forget, as you noticed in the video, the Family Fun Night date has been changed. That it was scheduled for this coming Sunday, November 6th. It's been moved to November 20th. So it's going to be a great time. I hope you'll put that on your calendar. Make sure you're there. Let's close in prayer. God, my heart's overwhelmed this morning with the goodness that we have received from you. I ask that you would keep us in your presence this week. Help us not to get too distracted, but to remember that we have received your goodness, and that's why we're still here. And I ask that you would open up the doors for us to be able to share that love with other people. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.